All right. Well, welcome everybody to the 2020-2021 liquid propulsion for LV4 capstone handoff. We have 10 people here. Glad to see lots of folks here. And the agenda is pretty loose, but we're just going to go over your entire project and try and get Lemmy to fail you so that you guys have to spend another year working on this project because you did a pretty good job on this one. And we'll go from there. All right, thanks. So JP, take it away, and everybody else who's talking, we're gonna interrupt each other and ask questions and all that kind of stuff. It's very loose, but let's bring up the proposal at the beginning.
All righty, we have our proposal.
Ah, not your proposal, our proposal.
Your proposal. We didn't do anything. Right. We have our members. It's myself, Marina, Emilio, Andrew, John, and Natalie.
Sorry, JP. I meant literally the requirements document that we gave to you for this project. Is that included in this document?
JP, if you're looking for it, I think it's in our 490X documents in our drive. I'm on my phone though, so I can't confirm. Copy of.
Ah, here we go. Yep.
Is that it?
Yeah, that's it. Thank you. Okay, so I like to go over this because this is what we asked you to do, and now we get to figure out if you actually did it, right? Extract performance requirements from the MDO for the current designs and the current design of the LV4 airframe and the 6 kilonewton liquid fuel engine. Design a flight capable system for LV4, analyze the design to show the system will operate safely. And then do we have a deliverables? Yes, down below. Zoom in on that a little bit so I can read it. We want a complete CAD model, a complete PNID, analysis including FEA and CFD as necessary, FMEA or HAZOPS report, build materials with a misspelling, and integration of the design into the MDO program. And then finally, complete documentation. Okay, thank you. All right, so did you guys do that?
We didn't write an SOP because we don't know how anything's going to work.
That's fine. That should have been with some caveats. This is all with caveats, so you're okay.
Yeah. CFD was done on the engine. We have for our pipe sizing, we do have a document where we did all of our sizing calculations for like pipe sizing and flow coefficients. We can run through that. So we have that. Let's go back to the leadership meeting notes. My thought was to first go kind of talk through our presentation, but we can just go straight into the document if you want to do that instead.
Oh, do you guys have the presentation today?
No, I just have the slides from it. We recorded it and sent it off a while ago.
Sure. Why don't you run through that? That's a great overview.
Okay. So we have the MDO, we had our spirals breakdown. So training PNID, we started with the LOX training that was run by a retired NASA test engineer at White Sands, as well as the General Base 11 safety training. We went through just overview of fluid system design, preventing fires, proper safety stuff.
We don't need details, that's fine.
Heard. Let's see. I guess I could put this into present, huh?
Sure.
If I know how to present.
And go fast over this part. Really, we want to get to the meat of it, which
breakdown
is the
CAD. Here, this is all of our stuff. We have Gantt charts. Marina has them in Microsoft Suite. There's base 11 deliverables as well. These are the trainings. We did the HAZOP which was a big old long process. Let's see how full HAZOP reports. In this document, it says why we did this, how we did this, and then we have our descriptions, design intent, and each node has its own color. So we went through everything we could think of on high, low pressure, high, low temperature, and high and low flow for each of the different nodes of our system. So this was us just trying to guess how it could go wrong and then preventing that from happening. And that doesn't mean that these are all the ways that it could go wrong. It almost definitely isn't. So we have the full worked out table here. I guess it's easier to do this if I'm flipping back and forward. And then there was the base 11 report that we did in the fall. PNID, oh yeah. So next step was to build out what the system needs to look like. Can I just open a new tab? Let me just download it. All right, so top to bottom, we have our ground support, fill valves, a filter before anything enters. This is our nitrogen reserve tank. This tank supplies all of the nitrogen for the purge system, the tank pressurants, the pneumatic valve actuation, and also the RCS, which is outside of our capstone, but above all of our junk. Any of these circles are going to be indicators. So we have pressure transducers and temperature transducers, but temperature sensors. So whenever you see those, we're monitoring either temperature or pressure. These three regulators bump down the pressure from our supply tank pressure to whatever we need it to be. This one, as you can see, goes to the LOX tank. We have one that goes straight through the avionics module into the fuel tank, and one that circumvents everything and goes into our purge system to get any residual propellant out of the EFS and engine after we're done firing. So this one is called the under N2 module for all purposes. Next, we have our above fuel module. Here we have another regulator, which brings us down to actuator pressure so that we can, these hexagons are connects between the pneumatic valve and the nitrogen supply at low pressure. We have a burst disc to prevent the regulators from exploding. We have another burst disc to prevent the tank from exploding. We have a check valve so we don't get backflow up into our nitrogen tank. This is going to be our pressurant valve. So this one will be on when we want pressure in the tank and off when we don't. And then we have a vent for the fuel tank. So when we're filling, we don't want to build pressure in the tank. So this will be open. And for these valve symbols, the filled in ones are normally closed and the open ones are normally open. So that means in their power off state, will you be able to pass anything through it? So this one, if there's no power, you can't get anything into the tank. But if there's no power, you can't keep any pressure in the tank as well. So we have our burst disc, we prevent overpressurizing, check valves to prevent backflow, and then our vent valve into our tank. Then we get into our between tanks module. We've got a little bit of fuel stuff in green and some nitrogen stuff in blue. So we have our fill into the fuel tank, or another filter and another valve. More sensors to make sure that the tank is at the right pressure and temperature. We have our fuel run valve. So this will allow us to get the fuel from the tank down into the EFS. And over on the left side, we have our pressurant for the LOX tank. So we have a similar thing. We have a burst disc to stop the valve and regulator from exploding. We have a burst disc to stop the LOX tank from exploding. We have our vent valve for the LOX tank for the same reason as the fuel tank. And then another regulator so that we can supply air to our pneumatic actuators, which are all labeled with hexagons again. And we have our fin can guts. So we have our, the LOX fill is a little more, there's a little more to it than the fuel and the nitrogen, because LOX, you fill a LOX tank by using self-pressurization in the Dewar. So as the LOX boils off in the Dewar because it's a cryogenic, that creates gas pressure, which then pushes the LOX out of the tank. So we have two check valves to stop anything from going backwards. We have a pressure relief valve to stop overpressurizing in the fill line. So this one will be set to about 22 PSI because the integrated pressure safety valves on the Dewar is rated to 25, and we want ours to pop before the Dewar's because we don't want them to be mad at us. And then we can go into our fill valve with a filter, which then goes into the tank. More sensors. We have our LOX run valve so we can get everything going into the EFS. And then this sneaky little blue line coming in from the side is our purge. So this is nitrogen straight in from this regulator up top. We have a branch off so we can actuate our valves, burst disc to stop anything from exploding. And then we have these two check valves which only allow flow from this node here outwards. So the LOX and the fuel can't go into the purge system, but we can get the nitrogen out to get rid of any leftover propellant. We go through the EFS, which is a bit of a black box in this, and we'll talk about it more in a second. Then each of them goes into a cavitating venturi. These have a curved profile on the inside where for a designated pressure, allow a maximum flow rate before cavitation starts to occur in the liquid, where you get bubbles and choked flow. And this is how we regulate our flow rate after coming out of the EFS. Just from a 10,000 foot view, what the EFS does, that's the electric feed system, is it ramps up the pressure to what we need the tank pressure, the chamber pressure to be once it passes through. So we have our venturis, and then we have more sensors afterwards, and this all goes into the engine bell.
Good. Since we're here on the PNID, a couple sort of figures of merit. What are the current, final for you guys, what are the final tank pressures right now?
The last time we asked, we put a minimum at 100. And so I think I didn't translate what Corey's last MDO run was into PSI, but that's an easy thing to do.
The EFS system is designed around 64 PSI and 75 PSI in the tanks.
Okay, good.
But that's all broken because reasons. Let's see. Constraints. So now we're at 270 PSI tank pressure.
Okay.
From Corey's run. So it went from, we put 100 PSI constraint when it was asking for 75, and now it wants 300.
This might be the modified run. He changed stuff to make it actually still reach 100 kilometers.
Yeah, that's correct.
With
that's
the one that's like a 14 kilonewton engine.
Oh, yep. That's the other thing. Yeah.
So that's right. So you, sorry, you're down, you're at 100 PSI. That makes sense, and that's kind of where we expected it. So, okay, good.
So that was our last one. So that was the bomb. Sorry, that was the P&ID. Valve selection.
Can I ask a quick P&ID question?
Yep.
A little bit of a derailing. Could you go to the diagram real quick? And then zoom in around the EFS and like purge system stuff.
This is facing backwards.
Okay, and scroll up a little bit, sorry. Is there, how does fluid between LC02 and PVL02 get purged?
It might not.
Okay.
This will boil off though. Because this will purge and then stop. So there is a chance that there will be small, like small amounts that might dribble, but we will get, so the thing is, we can't purge behind the valve necessarily because we have to close right. The valve in order to purge. And let's see where the purge is, because all those lines don't actually mean anything when it comes to spatial relation. So let me do this, make transparent. So this is the I'm so lost right now. So this is where the fuel is coming in from the from a fitting in the ring. So fitting to here comes out here into the EFS. And then we have this, which is our purge valve, which then lets nitrogen into here. So there might be some fuel trapped in here, but we can only purge what's directly going between the last connection and the EFS. So it's true. We might have some propellant slowly dribble out after the burn.
Yeah. Okay.
And that this is the kind of thing, Joe, that we'll start to really zoom in on as we get closer to building the dam.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Valve selection. So everything that we had, because it was relatively simple for us to get things in wide pressure ranges, we decided that if anything was going to fail, it wasn't going to be our capstone. So all of our components are rated for more than 325 PSI, which was the maximum design pressure of the IsoGrid tanks. So for flow capacity, we have this fun little sheet, which is sizing calculations.
Hmm.
So we have our mass flows that we input from the MDO. And then if we have our tubing sizes, our this is OD sizes, and then you have your wall thickness that you enter manually and you get your flow in feet per second. So that's how we do all of our tube diameter or just component diameter in general to see what we need. And then from there, parts like valves and pressure relief and pressure regulators and all that fun stuff, they use flow coefficients. And so in order to, you can kind of work back and forth with these. So these, you start with a flow coefficient, which is usually in the data sheet of what you're looking at. And then you have your inlet and outlet pressure. enter your specific gravity and your units, depending on what you want. And then you get a flow rate in what is usually standard cubic feet per minute or gallons per minute. So these have a different equation depending on if the pressure is more or less than a half of each other. And when you do this, there is an if statement. So as long as you put in the right pressures, it'll give you the right flow rate. So this is all here. And so materials compatibility, that is what we did the oxygen compatibility assessment for. This was a whole other. So we have a report of this, but we also have, so this is the same idea as the HAZOP, but I'm actually going to switch to the other sheet because it's a bit more readable, just because we can get it wider. So we got this here. We take so we have the data sheet linked so you can know what you're looking at. And then you have the material of the body, the seal, and the seat. The worst operating conditions, because this is cryogenic, the worst operating position, worst operating condition for temperature is around 100 degrees, which is our best guess of the components heating up after they've been sitting out in the desert for an hour inside the module. And worst case operating pressures, we had 300 PSI for tank pressure, 22 PSI for the LOX fill line. When we did this, the pressures would probably be lower, which actually decreases risk. So this is a conservative study. And then we look at the ignition mechanism ratings for particle impact, compression heating, friction, mechanical impact, electrical arc and spark, flow friction, and other. I'll talk about more about these in 1 second. We have the kindling chain, which is if this catches fire, does something else catch fire? And as you can see, the answer is almost always yes. The only one being the filter on the inlet, because you're not going to burn much else. And then the reaction effect, which is if this catches fire, what happens to everything? And you can see it is D, which is catastrophic, because if we start a fire in a module, we're all dicked. A LOX fire, at least. Mm-hmm. So the reference that we use, the main one is ATSM Manual 36 Second Edition, which is safe handling of oxygen systems. And so in what you want to look for is Chapter 2 is the ignition mechanisms, and they have different characteristic elements of each ignition mechanism, and then it'll tell you a little bit about it or give you a little bit of information on what could actually cause that to happen. So also our gas velocities for LOX have to be under 30 meters per second and 100 feet per second, but this is for particle impact. So it has one of these tables for pretty much each one. Some of them are not listed in that table and are the ones that are considered other. So we have the chemical reaction I was just making sure I was still recording because I didn't see anything.
Yeah.
Chemical reaction, thermal runaway, external heat, and resonance are all ones that are pretty uncommon, but you should still look at, which is why they're labeled as other. If you want a broken down look at our thought process going into the oxygen compatibility assessment, this 493 homework 2 is kind of a case study of the oxygen compatibility assessment for a single valve. Mm-hmm. So we have our evaluation on why we rated it as what for each. So this is a good document that's way too long, but actually gets the point across of why each of those choices were made.
Good. So
that's in the Google Drive. Let's see, what do we have?
A nice example.
I'm sorry?
That's a good example.
Yeah. You can thank Ike for making us do it as a homework assignment. All right, bill of materials. Let's see. All right, so let me zoom out of this just tiniest bit.
Actually, JP, before you jump on to that, I'm trying to see if there's a disconnect between what you and Corey are using. You just said a minute ago, the LOX velocities are 30 meters per second.
That is correct.
Because I want to say that Corey has stated 30 feet per second before.
So he has. And when we did the LOX training at the beginning of this year, I brought it up and I said, hey, why are we using 30 feet per second to prevent particle impact? It's 100 feet per second. And what I was told was that there was a concern of cavitation of the liquid oxygen flowing through the pipes, which is why we wanted to keep it slower. And it wasn't because of particle impact. So I did ask about that and I was told otherwise. But if we can do 100 feet per second, then cool. I was told to keep it at 30 for cavitation concerns.
Okay. Is there like a particular component that would be cavitation concern?
I think it was just general pipe flow, but.
Okay. Thanks, JP.
Yeah, I'm not sure because I was confused about that and I was told otherwise, and I think it would be worth going back to check again.
Yeah, considering that seems to be one of our primary design drivers at the moment.
Yeah, now it's become the main constraint. So that would be a good case study of what speed we actually cavitate at. Because if we can increase that constraint, then we can make the MDO look a lot more like we want it to. And that may mean we don't have to scrap most of the work of this capstone.
Yeah, scrap it. You guys, we don't need it.
Yeah, we got the grade. You can toss it out now. This is just for my records.
Did we get a grade? Have we been graded yet?
We got a grade on our poster.
100%?
Oh, yeah. So we have the bomb now. We have the P and ID name for easy reference, so you can bounce back and forth between those documents. Then you have a name of what the part is. The node is not filled out, but it's pretty easy to tell from this first letter. N is nitrogen, F is fuel, L is LOX, E is engine. Yeah. Common name, status, designed or specified. It's a dropdown. We have not ordered or received any of these. The only two that are unspecced are the Venturis because it depends on final tank pressure and also the chamber pressure of the engine, because this will work based on a pressure that we don't know yet. But we do know where we want to get them from. We want them from Flowmax.
I did make a Excel spreadsheet that you stick in your inputs and it calculates the size you need, which is in the GitHub repo for liquid fuel.
That's in the GitHub repo. We'll go through that afterwards. Bomb, we have spec sheet, which are all linked at the end. Industry part number, price, quantity, cost. We have mass in here as well, manufacturer distributor, and rated pressure when applicable.
This is great.
So that is all in there and organized.
Are any of the airframe people on? Can we make fun of the airframe people for not having bill of materials and for you guys having great bill of materials?
I'll text Katie.
Okay, thanks.
All right. Into EFS. Natalie, do you want me to hand off screen share to you if you want to kind of go through what we've done?
We can stay on your screen.
Okay,
cool. Just to make things easier. But the electric feed system for this project was mostly just about integrating the 2018-2019 project into the new LV4 parameters. And with the new thrust and tank and chamber pressures, that mostly just means new motor selections. And those are very specific to the pressure differential from the tanks to the chamber. So every time the MDO changes, the motor selection is going to change too. So this design that we've got from this capstone is based on the MDO output from February. And so if we go with a different MDO output later on as the final design, the only thing that would have to change would be a motor reselection and then slight dimensional changes on the impeller sizes.
All right, let's go through some of the stuff we have in here. This is the impeller design worksheet.
That is the thermal expansion worksheet. So that just comes into play when you start manufacturing the impellers and the housing, just to account for the thermal expansion due to the cryogenic fluids. So that just comes into play when you're actually building the impeller and the housing later on.
Cool. Motor specs, this was a big one.
Yeah, so that's just a list of pretty much every available motor that's going to give us the power and speed requirements that we'll be looking at for this 8 kilonewton or larger engine. And the orange there and the blue there is the fuel and LOX respectively, the ones that we've chosen.
And so now the MDO will output the necessary power and RPM, right? And torque?
Correct. Well, no, not torque. Torque is secondary, but the MDO's got power and speed requirements spitting out for the EFS now, which is convenient for whoever's going to work on this next.
So they can reference all these motors from the MDO and come back to, they can get the requirements from the MDO and then reference this list to see if there's another one that will work for that.
And the MDO's got a factor of safety included on the output. So if we choose a motor that's exactly at the numbers that the MDO has, we'll be operating at 80% of those maximum values. So within a good factor of safety.
Good.
Sweet. Design calculation. Is there anything else you want me to make sure to click on?
No, that's pretty much it. It was mostly just, motor selection. You could go through the CAD if you want, but nothing changed, visually wise and CAD wise from the last capstone.
Okay, cool. Yeah, we'll do a full CAD run through.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. More EFS stuff. We will get into the CAD later. Your turn, Amelia.
Okay. I designed a liquid fuel engine. We started off with using RPA. We found that it's a really useful software tool. I think we should probably going to stick with it to some degree moving forward, especially as the engine design continues to change in response to the changing MDO. We tried to validate the the 2016 Capstone parametric script that they produced, but we were not able to. It looks like the engine they made fairly consistently goes above the melting temperature of the material. So there's pretty much very little factor of safety there. One thing that I noticed that wasn't present in the report was that they did some film cooling in there, which wasn't applied in that sort of verification step. But I still vote that we move away from it simply because there's a lot of undocumented work that they did, and the script itself is just not, it's a very, you would send another capstone in to make that script work, but I wouldn't recommend it. And then I made the design on Onshape. This is the 8 kilonewton engine design. It's worth noting this one's already outdated because the film cooling, there are 90 cooling channels, which produce some pretty tiny, some pretty thin fins, which is a manufacturing constraint. And then, yeah, I did my whole deep dive in regenerative cooling. You can see in the photo on the right that kind of shows the fuel path. It flows downward, counterflow to the engine flow direction. And yeah.
Sweet. All right, next is current CAD, major revisions, future work. So let's go to Onshape. All right, let's go top down. So we talked about the names of the modules earlier. Andrew, I moved the PRV off center for you. So that's there. This module still uses AN fittings. That is because we don't have anywhere where components are butted up against each other. So the orientation of the fitting matters as much. When a tube goes onto either side of an AN fitting, that's just the way it goes. So we have one coming straight down, which will pressurize the fuel tank. One that pressurizes the LOX tank and one for the purge. We have our nitrogen supply tank up above and a pressure sensor so we know what the tank is at. So this one doesn't have as much going on. All the fill ports use these quick disconnects, which are made for chemical applications. So they're valved and non-spill, so we can use them for LOX as well without needing some sort of shutoff valve on the rocket side when we fill. So that's nice. Let's go back and then forwards. Above fuel. So we have these are all swage lock fittings. The nice thing about them is it doesn't matter what orientation you put them until you tighten everything. So we can loose fit everything and tighten it one by one to make sure everything is in the orientation that we want. You can see right now some of the stuff is bumping into each other because somebody was rearranging it. But what you can do is you can move singular parts and make it all fit the right way. Hooray, everything's in the module now. So yeah, we have a burst disc here, which goes straight out the side so we don't vent all of our pressure into the module and cause damage. This is going to be our mini regulator so that we can supply nitrogen to the actuators, another pressure sensor. And then we use these same quick disconnects to attach to the tanks. What this lets us do is we can assemble everything that goes in this module and then just plug and play with the tanks. So we don't have to try and wrench anything onto the tank while we're also trying to put a module on at the same time.
Good idea.
So we can have everything strapped in, ready to go, and then essentially plug in all of our plumbing. And because these are valved, we don't have to worry about dust caps whenever they're disconnected. We should still probably like wipe it down or put some sort of like tape and bag over, but just to prevent anything on the outside, but we don't have to worry about the inside getting dirty, which is really handy. Because if you're not aware, LOX cleaning is a hassle and a half.
Yeah.
So that is our above fuel module.
Just curious, JP, do you think if we had gone with a 10-inch rocket that would have made the CAD work that much harder to get that all the equipment in?
Absolutely. It barely works as it is. And so the thing is we got, so these are valves that are made for gaseous oxygen use, and they're not necessarily cryorated. You can't get a cryo valve without a 1.5-ish foot bonnet that goes between the valve body and the actuator, which prevents icing of the actual actuator. And that's like an ASTM standard. So these are gaseous oxygen valves. We're using the same ones for everything. So you don't have, so we just have valves that are, if it's the right size, you can put it there. And then once we get down into the actual LOX tank or the fin can guts, there is a nitrogen purge, which displaces all of the air in the module that prevents icing of the actuators that will have to be tested and validated before we actually put it into use. But what I was trying to get at is as we get smaller, this little cast iron standoff becomes a larger and larger percentage of the total size. So you can see that it's almost kind of split into thirds, where the actuator is a little bit taller than the valve body, and the valve body is just a tiny bit taller than this cast of standoff. But because the inside is actually a rack and pinion gear, you can't make that pinion any smaller. So the only way to put a valve in, if we had 10 inches, was from like end to end, pretty much. Because if we lost 2 inches, it wouldn't have worked. And then we would have created even more problems than we already did. But yeah, here we are at the between tanks. We have our fill port, our fuel tank connect, our LOX tank connect. The fuel comes out through and then out so we can get it to the fin can. So that makes this our fuel run valve right here. And then we have our LOX pressurant valve and a burst disc in case of overpressure in the LOX tank. This is our vent valve, and then this is our fuel pressurant valve, my apologies. And then we have a little block manifold, which we can then get nitrogen from a low pressure regulator to the actuators. And we don't have the bracing because pretty much after we finished, we were told that all the sizing needs to change. So change in size means that every single one of these fittings, of which there are many, needs to be reselected for the proper size. And also the valve bodies will need to change size, but the actuators should still be perfectly capable. They just operate on a pressurized gas. So the pressure that we give it will determine the open and close speed of the valve as well. So let's go into the fun one. Let's see.
Hey, JP, can I ask you a question about your valves?
Sure.
So your valves all work here on the ground at sea level, basically. What will happen when you get up 67,000 feet? Are they still going to be, will they still stay open?
So it's a pneumatic cylinder. So I don't know. So my thought is that because it's a closed system, if the ambient pressure changes, it shouldn't have much effect on the inside of the actuator. And so because we're still supplying the gas directly into that cylinder, we should be okay. But yeah, that is something I haven't actually thought about.
It's a good question. I can't think of anything, because you're right, it's a closed system, but that's really, that things were going to expand, you know, it's going to be a bigger pressure differential, stuff like that. Interesting.
So yeah, if anything, the valves would either A, open faster, or in an extreme case where the air inside is trying to get out, it would open all of the valves. Well, it would turn all the valves into their powered on state.
Right.
Which would mean that we would keep burning until we're out of propellant, and we would deplete all of our nitrogen. Actually, we would purge and fire at the same time. So we would like sputter until we ran out of fuel. But that is not something we have thought about.
Yeah, definitely a thing to look into. My understanding of like pneumatic valves was that when you're trying to power the valve, you're applying pressure to the back of the cylinder. And when you're not powering the valve, you're venting the back of the cylinder and allowing the spring to return it to its position. So I would assume it would just...
Yeah, because the vents open when
vent
it's...
faster.
Yeah, it would vent faster. Yeah, that makes sense.
Oh, but we're imagining if there's air trapped in the side of the spring.
But well, so you're right. When it's unpowered, the vent is open because we don't have double acting actuators. It's just spring return. So that means that when the valve is in an unpowered state, the vent is always open. Mm-hmm. We don't have to worry about trapped gas in the actuator, because what happens is when we add air, the vent closes, it spins, and then yeah, you're right. It might not even close faster because it's spring return.
Right.
One way it might impact the system design is if you're running the actuators right up next to the edge of when the overpressure relief, because I think it might have the effect of adding 15 PSI to the actuator pressure system.
Could you say that one more time, Mark?
Yeah, you might just add... it might just add some extra effective pressure to the actuator system. I'm thinking like the test stand has pressure safety valve for the actuators at 100 PSI. You're running it at 90 PSI, and then you take away all the outside pressure. I think that would make your gauge pressure higher.
Yeah. Well, that would probably be a good thing to look into. We can vacuum test the once we get the vacuum chamber running, we can put the valves in there and actuate them. But here we are at the fin can. We have our burst discs up high. We have fuel in. This is our locks coming down and through into, locks coming down and through, locks run valve, which comes out here. And so we don't have much chance. The only place that locks could stay in when we purge locks, at least, is right here, because we have our nitrogen purge over here, which will come up through this check valve and then will come out to the EFS. So even if we have a little bit of fuel trapped when we purge, we can only have like 1 cubic inch of LOX at cryo temp, which would then start to boil off. And I'd rather have fuel sitting around than LOX. So that's one thing. We have our nitrogen in where it branches off for our actuators, comes down for the purge. This will be connected to one of the burst discs. LOX comes out into the respective EFS. And then we kind of talked about this a bit. Fuel comes in here, out here, and then we have that nitrogen coming from the purge valve up through a check valve as well. And then we get to the EFS in the CAD. These blocks are our electronic speed controllers, which are put right up against this T where the fuel is. So this is how we're going to cool our ESCs. So while we're running, we have fuel going through here, which will cool down the fittings, which will then cool down the ESCs, our electronic speed controllers. We have our plethora of batteries to run these motors for the burn time. Then we have some pressure sensors in as we go into the EFS. We go through and then out, and these are our cavitating venturis right here after the EFS, so we can make sure to regulate our flow rate into the engine. Let's see, can I go to this document? All right, so this is the LOX pump assembly. We have...
This has not changed since the last capsule, has it?
No, it has not. Just some slight dimensional changes.
Yeah.
But the concept design is the same.
Great.
Let me... So yeah, we have fuel in, we have our impeller, our space comes out over here, and then bearings and seals and couplings, and then our motor. So if you want an in-depth on the impeller design, that would probably be in a previous Capstone video that is on YouTube. And then we'll take a quick look at the LFE CAD.
It's actually in the propulsion folder.
Oh, thank you.
Can you go back to that whole assembly for just a minute, the fin can assembly?
Yep.
Spin around just for a second. Yeah, okay. Okay, so we actually have room.
Ish, yes.
Yeah, okay. All right, interesting.
What, you want to make the fin can smaller?
Yeah, we're going to go down to 8 inches.
Tall?
sorry, just pan up for a second at this scale. Okay. All right, good. All right, thanks. So we're going to go to the LFE?
Yep. Ooh. All right, let's see if I can section view this in the right place. That is the wrong place. That's the right place. All right, so we have our in, and then you can see our little channels running through to our out. And then we attach it to the bottom. I don't know, Emilio, you want to talk more about what's going on here?
Yeah, sure. You might want to follow my view.
Oh, that works.
So if I can chop a section view also. Oh, okay, that does work. Okay, cool. Yeah, so the LFE is based off of two separate fuel manifolds. The inlet fuel manifold is here near the throat, where it goes into these quarter-inch MPT taps. There's three total to try to make sure there's no like kind of low pressure zones between them. The original capstone just produced one with one fuel inlet, which I didn't think was good. In here, you've got this basically a donut ring of isopropyl alcohol, where it then filters into these channels, which are all the way around this manifold. There's no fillets here because Onshape has issues with like 90 instance patterns. We might be able to remake this in SolidWorks in the future. So then the fuel kind of runs through these channels, which you can kind of notice are changing dimension. We change dimension to make sure they have a constant cross-sectional area. It gets a little weirder on this area. I had to make some slight changes, but it's close to constant. Specifically, so you have these high aspect ratio channels in the throat. This could be changed in the future. The constant cross-sectional area was an assumption that the original capstone team made that we just kind of ran with. It doesn't need to be kept, and we can't actually reduce or increase these cross-sectional areas, specifically in the throat, to change the temperature. Then it goes back out, again, narrowing to keep constant cross-sectional area as the channels widen, and then it comes to the exit manifold. Again, same style of design, 3/4-inch MPT taps, which then outlet. The idea is, current idea with this design is that you bolt on an injection plate. But one shortcoming of this is that to make a fuel flange, you need like a lot of space. So the injection plate needs to slide up to like almost here where the regenerative cooling really starts, which I don't think is a good design. I'm gonna recommend a future iteration of this engine actually kind of fall back on the original design that the capstone team used, which is having a, basically filling in this gap and having a built-in injection plate. That will mean there's some more internal geometry that we need to kind of be aware of, but it makes your machining process a lot simpler. And because we're additively manufacturing, we are able to do these complex internal geometries. And it also makes doing film cooling easier also, because you just have film inlets kind of at the right where the chamber starts, as opposed to having to like do some wonk crazy stuff like the injection plate or machine them into the walls. It's a lot easier. This plate here, the one we're using to kind of, I don't know, the flange that we're bolting through, is basically just a placeholder. I'm going to recommend that it gets redesigned or removed or simplified as we add in the built injection plate. These are, I think, 1/4-inch holes, but again, they're just kind of placeholders. Are there any questions right now?
Is it done?
Are you kidding? Nothing's done.
Yes, ready to fly.
I mean, I think this would work. It's an 8 kilonewton engine. It's it's a little close to the minimum distance that our additive manufacturing process can make, but it's not smaller than that. It's theoretically manufacturable. Yeah. I wasn't able to find a way to, I know you wanted to have like a way to thread a camera through these holes. I don't think that's gonna be possible.
Yeah, okay.
Not without like some real crazy designs, and you have like potential leaks, and there's no way to get like a seal up to work with these cooling channels.
Right. Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, any questions? No? Okay, then I'll pass it back to...
Sorry, one last one, Emilio. So yeah. I just want to reconfirm that we should probably abandon the Python generation script, and RPA will do what we need it to do to some extent, so we're just replacing it with that.
RPA does, as far as I can tell, everything the Python generation script does, plus...
Okay, cool. And it's been validated.
Yep. Oh, yes. I ran some pretty... frustrating CFD work to make that, to check that the engine curve it was generating was accurate.
Yeah. Okay, good. Thank you.
And all of Amelia's stuff is in the GitHub. Hooray.
Yep, so I've got multiple RPA files in different analysis folders. I did some for the 2 kilonewton engine.
Good.
But the 8 kilonewton engine is the one we're currently working on, assuming that 8 kilonewton engine is what we actually need and that right. MDO doesn't change again.
Which it did, but that's fine.
Yeah, you know.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Let's finish this out. This was just a slide about why we changed to Swage Lock.
Wait, go back. That was kind of vaguely interesting for those of us who don't know what they are.
Yeah, so this okay. is the AN style fitting. You have a flare tubing and a little collar right here. And the first time that you screw these on tight, you actually deform what they call the sleeve
mm-hmm.
a little bit around, which creates the compression fit on the flared fitting and the tube. So that's great, but you use it in conjunction with NPT, which means that you don't know which way this is pointing when you screw it in, which is fine if you're connecting to a tube. But if you're doing NPT to NPT, then everything breaks. These are nice. These are the swage style fittings. So they can have an NPT end, but when you attach something, you just put a tube in any orientation, and then you clamp down, and these two collars get attached to the tube itself.
Mm-hmm.
So that when you bring it, when you pull these apart, you have this attached to whatever you screwed it into, and then this is all connected to the tube you screwed it onto the first time. And so if you need to rebend a tube, you can buy these little parts to replace it, so you don't need an entirely new fitting. You can just replace like the ferrules and things like that. And you can choose exactly how far away things are from each other.
Yeah.
And future work, ground support system. We picked everything that we would need. What we didn't do is figure out how to get it together. And the interior module support structures need to be made. That is assuming that we don't have to reselect every part that we've chosen, which there is a good possibility of. So once we have everything in the right spot, we need to make sure we can keep it in the right spot. We have the quick disconnects for all the fill ports. But now we need some sort of mechanism that we can detach our quick disconnects from the actual airframe when we're all half a mile away and the rocket is on the rail.
Yeah.
So that can be something as simple as like a linear actuator with a collar to just push it straight off the airframe or whatever people think would be best. But that hasn't been done. We have to test and validate nitrogen purge to make sure that that is actually capable of preventing mm-hmm. icing, because mm-hmm. it might not get enough of the air out, or it might just be a dud. But in theory, if you replace all the air and there's no moisture, then you can't make ice. So it should work. We need to make sure it does. Depending on final EFS outputs, we need to reselect motors. Sorry, final MDO outputs, we need to reselect EFS motors. And then some more LFE as always, because the engine is never done until we explode it. And one of the big things that we are added today is we need to look back at the constraint for 30 feet per second in the LOX line. If it can be more, that's awesome. That gives us a better chance that what we've spent the last year doing might be useful.
Mm-hmm.
Now we can kind of, we can go through the final report. We can skim through it. Oh my goodness, where are we? Do we want to take a question break or keep pushing?
Let's keep pushing.
Okay. All right, contributions, executive summary. I don't know how you want me to go about this. Where do you want me to stop? Do we want to just go into subsystem highlights?
Sorry, no. Make it bigger, so a little bit bigger, like 150. Okay. All right, so subsystem highlights. Okay, so yeah, go to subsystem highlights. Yeah, okay, keep going. Excellent, okay, good.
I think we made it through most of the stuff. Oh, another thing we have, which are awesome and need to be updated, is we have these fitting diagrams, but they have not been remade for Swage Lock fittings.
Okay.
So having something that we can say, oh, this fitting goes there without trying to hunt through the CAD is really nice, and having them all labeled out. This was an awesome thing that we had done for the AN fittings, and we were trying to redo CAD and did not get the chance to remake these for Swage Lock, I believe, unless I'm incorrect, Andrew.
No, that's correct.
Okay, cool. Yeah, so redoing these for Swage Lock fittings would be awesome. We talked about the above fuel module and what goes in it, the between tanks.
Yeah, this is great.
Yeah, so I think most of the stuff in the paper we were just able to go through in the CAD and all that. A bunch of LFE stuff, RPA outputs. Hooray, things aren't melting. That is locks, sizing calculations, future work. We good. Just talked about all this.
Good. Excellent.
Yep.
All right, and then the appendices. Okay, good.
So P and ID, this is Capstone, CAD, and
great.
HAZOP is in here. This is the same system level matrix from in the report. Mm-hmm. EFS design calculation tool, battery selection for EFS, thermal expansion tool for EFS, LFE RPA output on engine bell contour, sizing calculation sheets, bill of materials, and then our ABET objectives.
Okay. Let's carefully go over the ABET objectives.
Okay.
Okay. Wow. Great. Excellent. That's a lot, and there's always 1,000 questions. Go ahead and open up Google Drive and show us where everything is.
Okay. So we are in PSAS shared drive, liquid engine test stand, which might not be the applicable place for
it. All right. Will you please go ahead and
move it to LV4?
No, just change your view so it's not the damn boxes.
I like my view.
Nope, screw your view.
How do you change? Is it this one?
Yeah. Oh,
gross.
Where's thank you.
Pictures? Now I don't know where anything is. Okay. All right. Then you have 2020-2021 flips capstone.
Okay, that's fine.
In here we have our sizing calculation sheet, our oxygen compatibility assessment sheet, not the report, and our meeting notes, technical resources, distributor lists, mm-hmm. A couple spec yep. sheets, engine report. EFS has its own folder because great. Of what it is. All of our 493 requirements, everything from project proposal, capstone presentation, which is a dumbed down version of what we were doing here. Our project plan is in there. Our work breakdown structure is in here.
Where is your final report?
There
it is, final report, sorry.
Yeah, and Google Doc. Yeah, so all of our final deliverables are up top. The poster's in here. The I'm going to rename this. This homework two is the oxygen compatibility assessment case study. So I'll rename that right now.
Mm-hmm. We should consider also just moving the final report PDF to the top level of the folder.
Thank you.
Then we have BOM, PNID, and HAZOP. We have our HAZOP report and HAZOP worksheet. Our BOM, our up-to-date PNID is here, or sorry. We have two of them, that's okay. This was one of the fittings diagrams, but this
How do you make those?
Andrew, was that just a PowerPoint?
No, it's draw.io.
Oh, great. Oh, I see him. Yeah. Oh, I'm glad you used draw.io. Thanks.
Mm-hmm. So archived is all of our old PNIDs. As you can see, it changed quite a bit. And then modules is where you'll find the fittings diagrams.
Okay. Nicely organized.
Yeah, so hopefully people will be able to see what we were doing. Yeah. I'm about ready to open it up for questions, and by that I mean beratement, but
no questions. We did everything right.
Perfect.
You did everything right.
Look at us.
There's too much to ask questions about. as always, it's a very complicated system. I'm going to ask you guys some questions, which is tell us sort of post-mortem, what feedback do you guys have for us about how your capstone went?
I think it would have been handy to be in person, first of all, which of course nobody has any control over, especially the beginning stages. I think that being together for things like, one, the safety training would have been really handy, but also things like working out the PNID. And now, like as a group, we can talk about something on the PNID and go look at it. But when we were doing things like the HAZOP and everybody had the PNID open on their own screens, it was really hard to like keep everybody on track about where everything was.
Mm-hmm.
I think that I don't know how much more analysis we would have needed, but I think that LFE alone could have been its own capstone.
Yes.
Yeah,
I think that EFS, because it was integration, could make sense that it was lumped in with us. But I think if we did plumbing and EFS, like all internals and then all externals, because if we didn't have LFE, we probably would have been able to work out things like the ground support equipment and stuff like that, and organizing that and trying to get like a detaching mechanism for our fill lines.
Yeah.
So like we have like a really good baseline of what we need, but I think now the little details are spread. Like now there's the little things to get done, but there's like little things that three different teams would probably end up doing.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, the scope was a little wild on this capstone.
Yeah, we kind of got like a grab bag of non-airframe things.
Max asked, is the LFE parametrics generation script going to be archived? The answer is it already is on GitHub, in the sense that it's just checked into GitHub and we'll never We'll never delete it. We'll keep it forever.
No, I think Max, were you the one who was actually working on the LFE script? Because I think.
Yeah, I was working on it for a while. And then since RPA is just going to work anyway, I should probably just hide it in an archive folder.
That works too, yeah. It's a cool script to have, and the geometry it seems to generate is like close. Seems to be kind of close to what you want. I was using it as starting points when I was kind of while I was making the switch, I was using it as a starting point. It's actually, again, it's like pretty close.
Yeah, there were a few errors that I was trying to bug out.
Yeah.
Things.
I found one I could talk to you if you want to keep working on it, but if you don't, it doesn't matter.
I have no idea.
Okay.
If we have Max as a coding resource, then we should throw him on something, you know, good, like useful, immediately useful.
Yeah, because I'll need a new project if the LFE parametric script is going to be put on hold or just archived.
Yeah. Well, Max, I forget, are you CS or?
No, I'm actually a mechanical engineering major, but I do have some CS background. I'm an amateur in that sort of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I think it makes sense for PSAS to buy a yearly license for RPA, because right now, the way that YouTube worked, Emilio has RPA for life, and that's it.
Right? No, that's not true. We actually did buy...
Oh, we did buy it as PSAS?
We did buy a yearly one-year subscription for PSAS.
Oh, okay.
I have codes which I can throw out like candy at people. It'll need to be bought every year if we want to keep doing that, though.
Yeah.
Which is, as long as you do engine work, I think it's worth it.
Yeah, absolutely.
The light version isn't enough. I saw that there was a free version.
There's a free version. Part of RPA is like running it, seeing if that works, changing a thing, running it, seeing if that works. And they know this. So the free version, you can run three times and then you have to save and reboot. And it's like a really great free model because it's just obnoxious enough to really mess with your workflow.
Okay.
Emilio, would you make just like a quick document, just like a Google Doc that has the code that you need in the front of LFE? Or I don't know where the code is.
You mean the RPA stuff?
Yeah.
That's already checked into the liquid fuel.
Oh, it's in the GitHub?
I've been doing all the RPA work through the GitHub. My various files are saved there, and we called it out also in our capstone report.
Oh, but JP is exactly right. There should be some link from within the Flips capstone folder to this. So just make a Google Doc and just say all the LFE design work can be found in this Git repo.
Okay.
Fair
enough.
Is that in the end of the...
I mean, I linked the repo at the end of this report.
Yeah, but it's good to have it in the... Still good to have it in the thing.
Didn't I?
Did
Maybe.
You? I don't know if you did.
Oh. I should have.
Down here, low. Nope. It's not linked.
Thought I did. Okay. I'll add a link to that.
Not related to engine stuff, but Max, you might be interested in like RCS attitude control-y stuff.
Yes.
Okay.
Where did you want the folder, JP?
Oh, my thought was to just put it in LFE and not Flips.
Isn't the RCS thing where they were controlling the roll of the rocket?
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, Andrew, I have a question for you. The question is, after listening to the LV4 and this and some of the other capstones we've had in the past, do we need a systems, overall, a systems team of some kind?
An overall systems team?
Right, for integration. In other words, you have a variety of different capstones you do in different years, some based upon some information. The information keeps changing. But what I'm trying to say is, at the moment, there's no overall system. We're doing everything in pieces, and I'm concerned listening, like, you know, the flow requirements of the oxygen and so forth. Do we need somebody to help arbitrate when there's differences between the different pieces. Because I'll tell you, my experience is things, that's where they break down.
Yeah, well, that's exactly right. I mean, that's the whole problem is we've got a system of systems of systems.
Right, and we have
interfaces three or four.
Where things break.
Right, and that's technically that's Corey, Corey's going away. We need someone to replace Corey. That's probably the most important thing in terms of LV4 is finding a new Corey, and finding a Corey who's more of a mechanical engineer systems person is probably the right way to go, so that they own. And can own all the different systems as an overview. Because you're right, Ed, at this moment, we've kind of gone as far as we can go with separate systems.
Right.
And it's about time, because we're going to start building stuff, it's about time to really figure out what we're doing system level wise. Right now, we're exactly where we should be, which is the MDO is a disaster. We don't make 100 kilometers with the current system. It's too heavy. You know, like all of these terrible problems, which is a super good sign. If we didn't have terrible problems, we wouldn't be doing it right.
No, I understand.
Yeah, but yeah. So
what I'm saying, though, is that a capstone? Because
no, it's not. At the very least, it's a master's thesis or PhD dissertation.
Right, because also you got to worry about ground support.
Yep. Yeah, no, I really don't think this is a capstone. The capstones are good at a system, not a system of systems.
Okay, so somehow or other, though, if we're going to go ahead with LV4, in my opinion, we need to think through this and come up with a plan for systems engineering.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
I mean, I'm not trying to knock anything anybody else has done up till now. They've done excellent work as undergrads, but
We're already to the point where we're going to make strategic bad investments, time and effort, without having the overall system stuff more nailed down. Yeah.
So I completely agree with Andrew that we need to find a new Corey, but also, Ed, part of this gets covered through the LV4 MDO meeting that we've been having every week. So the systems haven't been not talking to each other this whole time. And I think we should continue that meeting as we go forward.
I think it becomes more important now.
Right. Okay.
Yeah. And the airframe team earlier said something that I thought was good, which is that they wish that there would have been one more of these kind of integration meetings between all the teams and PSAS. And I think that was missing. I think we should have done that. And we should have forced all the capstone members to make it, not just the leads. But have everybody be there because it's just invaluable time to ask questions, discuss assumptions, all that kind of stuff.
All right. Is there any final comments before I stop this recording?
Did you want to take any technical questions? Just one small thing I wanted to ask.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I was curious, and I don't know if something was commented on it because I'm doing other stuff. For the combustion chamber on the engine, you know, I saw it has all the plumbing built into the surround of the case. And this is going to be 3D printed. For manufacturability, curious about that. Do we know whether or not they can clear out the material in there?
Here?
Yeah, because it's all going to be packed full of, you know, powdered metal still. And it's kind of hard to clean those channels out. And if it is the case that it, you know, that it might be difficult. Yeah, if it is the case that it might be difficult to clean, I understand all the interior dimensions of it, you know, they're all, you know, defined in scripts generated. The exterior dimensions of it, are those do those need to follow, you know, the profile of the interior like that?
They do not. It really is the channel dimensions that are what's specified.
Okay.
I've looked into this a little bit and I found a big old paper on additive engine manufacturing.
Mm-hmm.
From what I understand, they can flow there's a specific name for this. I'm just going to describe the process. They basically flow a liquid with a little bit of grit in it that through these channels as though, like, kind of like a cold flow of the channels, basically.
Okay.
And the idea is that like that will flush out any of that metal dust that's left over.
Cool. Yeah, I've seen them do it with like an ultrasound bath also to get everything loosened up and then they can flow through. Mm. But I'm not, you know, I've got CAD vision on this. I don't, that dimension of that channel, you know, I don't really.
Is tight.
Yeah, it's, yeah. It looked tight. It looked like it might be.
At thinnest, it's in the like 1.5 millimeter range.
Yeah.
I think we had a problem with the regenerative cooled engine that we designed a while ago in that when they manufactured. Was that recalled? Do you remember that, Andrew?
Yeah, that's right.
Go ahead.
I was going to say, this was designed with that in mind, that theoretically speaking, on a good 3D printer with a good process, this should be okay. But we won't know that for sure until we try and get it made. So, yeah.
A lot of the particulate that was left inside of the previous Capstone's engine was actually where the printer head broke the fins off as it passed over. So it wasn't as much residual powder, more than the actual like sintered metal being broken off back into the channels.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, they'd experienced literal print failing because the cooling ribs were so thin. That was one of the changes that I was specifically made. And that one of the changes that needs to be made when we model this engine again is to make those ribs thicker, unfortunately, which will, fewer channels will increase the engine wall temperature, but it'll make it more manufacturable. So there's a little balance to find.
Yay. Turns out everything is optimization.
Yeah.
Always.
It's engineering.
Okay. Good. Let's go ahead and kill the recording, JP. Thank you, guys. Good job. Seriously, good job.